After 10 race weekends to get to this point, the moment we've been waiting for is finally here. The beginning of the inaugural FARC-Off. 15 drivers will start this playoffs in hopes of becoming the 2016 champion. However, by the time the finale rolls around, only 5 drivers will be able to race for that opportunity. Everything that's happened so far this season was just to get to this point, as drivers tried to win races in order to lock themselves into the FARC-Off. For those who couldn't win, they had to maintain a steady points position in order to get in that way. Now, qualify for the FARC-Off was quite simple. Win a race and you're in, so long as you remain in the top 40 in points. However, if you win more than one race, you qualify regardless of where you are in points and how many races you run. The remaining spots are determined by points position. So we got our 15 drivers that will race for the title. So how do we determine a champion? That's where it gets a little more complicated. The FARC-Off is split into 2 separate rounds, both with 3 race weekends apiece, with the elimination races being double headers, meaning that there's technically 4 races in a round. After each round, 5 drivers will be eliminated, cutting the field from 15 to 10, and then, after the second round, to the championship 5, who will race for the title at the finale at Texas World, where the highest finishing among those 5 will be the 2016 FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series champion. So, how do you advance to the next round? Well, there's actually 3 criteria used to determine who advances to the round of 10. The first one is the easiest one, and that's by winning. You win a race and you advance. Keep in mind that you have more than half the field that's not racing for a title that could possibly steal wins from the FARC-Off drivers. We'll see how that plays into effect. The second criteria is, just like the qualification for the FARC-Off, is by points. The highest ranked 6 drivers without a win will advance to the round of 10, meaning if you don't win a race, you can still get in on points, assuming that you run all of the races in the round. Now, why would that be a factor? That's because a few of the drivers in this FARC-Off field got in while running limited schedules. Now, you're probably thinking, isn't that a little unfair to them? Well, that leads to the final criteria to qualify for the round of 10, and that is average finish. After the race winners and the 6 that make it in on points, the remaining spots are determined by average finish, meaning you don't necessarily have to run every race in the round in order to meet the necessary criteria to advance. This means that the drivers that are on part-time schedules and won't be able to get the necessary points to advance, they can still get in on their average finish. At the end of the doubleheader weekend at Grand Detour, 5 of our 15 will be eliminated, while the rest of them will advance to the round of 10. We'll talk about how you advance from there once we get to it. Although you don't necessarily have to run every race to qualify for the FARC-Off, some teams have already made accommodations for said drivers in order to make their chances of advancing to the round of 10 much easier. So here are some of those changes. The first is Mark Thompson. They've announced this week Ashley Tucker is out of the full-time 64 car to make room for Thompson so that Thompson could go for points. Tucker is racing this weekend, however, in the 61. However, we believe that is a one-off, and not sure how many more races we'll see her this season. It's a shame for Tucker, who got bumped out of a ride, but when you have one of your drivers fighting for a championship sometimes, especially with this system, you're going to have to make some difficult decisions. The next change is that of Johnson Clapp, the winner at 70-77. It was announced this week that Clapp will also be running for points, and this week he is running the 09 for Wild West Racing, the car that's normally driven by Jason Bates. It is said that Wild West Racing will field additional entries for him when necessary. The next bit of news involving Tristan Kristoff, who barely made the FARC-Off after winning at a road course appearance at Road America, and since then gathering as much points as possible, driving for Team Burr in order to get into the top 40 in points to qualify for the FARC-Off. He will also be going for points, jumping in between the 69 car for Wild West Racing, the same team he won at Road America with, and Team Burr, the team he's been driving for since. However, this weekend, he's driving for the AJ Young team, another backmarker team, just trying to get as much points as possible to make the best of a bad situation, because that team really isn't built to win races, and neither is Team Burr, as we know. And the final bit of news is involving Leslie Riggs, who we have not seen since she won at Sayre the second race weekend of the year. However, despite that, she still remained in the top 40 to be eligible to run for the FARC-Off. In fact, we didn't even know that she was going to make a championship run until just this past week, when it was announced she will be driving a second Motor Assault Racing entry, the 29, for this week and the elimination race at Grand Detour. However, I do not believe she's entered for Watkins Glen, the second race in the round. And that is it for the shuffling around that's been caused because of the FARC-Off. I have rambled long enough, let's finally get to the race. Monica Rook, a non-FARC-Off driver, is on the pole. However, there are four FARC-Off drivers starting in the top six, led off by Lev Vazarov. Taylor Brillin, another non-FARC-Off driver, starting in third and is immediately going to take the second spot from Azarov as he runs turns one and two a bit wide. Billy Ray Smith-Thompson, Bob Steffens, and Chuck Johnson among the other FARC-Off drivers that started in the top six. Rook's going to lead the first lap, and it looks like Bob Steffens back there is going to run turn three a bit wide, almost in the wall. He just barely misses it, but Chuck Johnson's going to bounce off a wall in front of Steffens. That's going to bunch everybody up behind him. Ricky McKenzie goes by them, and we got three wide here going down the front stretch. You may have saw briefly in the shot someone else bounced off the wall, only this time it's going to result in a wreck. Gio Arias bounces off into Dan Lechleiter. That's going to cause him to slide down the front stretch. And there was another incident behind that involving Keegan Mallory, who gets hit by Zach Webster, who also hits Lechleiter. Another incident happened after this. Ronnie Holter and Tom Brayton get together, and then Holter's gonna get spun by Kyler Spavital. So an instance of backmarkers wrecking each other. All cars involved in all incidents will continue. Meanwhile, in the race back to the caution, Taylor Brillin would get around Monica Rook and will lead them to the caution. Azarov will remain in third. Chuck Johnson would be the only one not involved in any of the incidents to come into pit road under this caution. Unknown what they're planning with this decision. Kyler Spavital would also come in under this caution, but he would come in one lap before they were scheduled to take the restart. In onset restart, Taylor Brillin will lead. Michael Rook still in second. Lev Azarov still in third. And Brillin gets a nice start and opens up the gap between her and Rook. And Azarov goes under Rook for, or attempts to go under Rook for the second spot, but then goes back up and hits the wall and almost into Rook. And because of that, Brillin's going to open up her lead a bunch. Let's take a look now at that battle for a second. Rook currently has it. Azarov and McKenzie currently battling for the third spot, and McKenzie runs the turn wide. Azarov bounces off the wall, and then that's another wreck. Azarov bounces off the wall into McKenzie, which causes an accordion effect, which results in McKenzie and Billy Ray Smith-Thompson sliding down the front stretch, while a majority of the field does a good job at avoiding it. A lot of cars do not, and then the track is blocked. You see Ashley Tucker on her side. Here we are following Tucker now. Here she is, a ways behind the wreck. And as I said before, a lot of drivers did a good job avoiding it. They slowed down, but some drivers did not. Kenny George III runs right into the back of Neil Miller, only after Miller scoops Tucker onto her side and upside down. After Tucker slowed down to avoid the wreck. Ralph West also involved. Smith-Thompson drives away with minimal damage, but a number of other FARC-Off drivers are also involved. Mark Thompson, Greg Gray, Dan Lechleiter, Leslie Riggs.
I slowed down the best I could. I believe we have a bit of right front damage.
Heard there from Chuck Johnson, who got a bit of damage in that trying to slow down and not really having anywhere to go. He, as well as Johnson Clapper, forgot to mention earlier, among the other FARC-Off drivers involved in this. Seven cars would retire from the race from this accident, four of which are FARC-Off drivers. That being Thompson, Lechleiter, Gray, and George III. They're going to get their FARC-Off started on a bad note. But meanwhile, everybody will come down pit road under this caution, and it will be the Gravity Racing cars of Sedane Quackenbush and Zach Gott that beat everybody on pit road by taking two tires. Joshua Pacer also took two tires. He's now in third. Or he would be, if it wasn't for the fact that Kyler Spavital, who came into pit road one lap before the restart on the last caution, is going to stay out and lead on this restart. Oh, this is going to be interesting. And the damaged car of Neil Miller passes him like he was standing still. Gravity Racing teammates also make quick work of Spavital, and he's now going to start dropping like a rock. Spavital actually doing a good job staying out of everybody's way, however he is holding up Jim Kidd. So that means Quackenbush is going to end up with the lead and actually open up a pretty big lead over his teammate Gott, who's trying to hold off Joshua Pacer for seconds. Here is Gott as he starts to pull away from Pacer a bit. Gott, the more experienced of the Gravity Racing drivers, a veteran of the truck series, he's now going for, I believe, his first full-time go in the Smash Beer Low Dollar Series, and yeah, I believe he hit the wall there. I believe he had a shared schedule a few years ago for them, if I'm not mistaken, and now Bob Steffens has moved into third, Bradley Carlisle right behind him. Pace is starting to drop back now. Steffens then washes up into Gott as Gott then slides into the wall. That's going to bring out the third caution of the day, and it's only lap 15. Luckily, no one else hits Gott, and he's going to drive away. This half racing back to the caution. Maury Holzer and Keegan Mallory are going to get together exiting turn 4, and they're going to spin each other out. This happened in the very back of the field, so no one else hit them. But back up front today, Quackenbush will easily beat everybody to the caution, and we had a close battle for second coming back to the line, with Bob Steffens barely beating out Bradley Carlisle for the spot. Under that caution, Joshua Pacer would pit from the fourth spot and would be the only one to do so, much like Chuck Johnson did on the first caution. Quackenbush would lead on the restart and will quickly pull in front of the lap car of Neil Miller, leaving Steffens and Carlisle to deal with them, but they're going to get around them pretty quickly as well. Steffens more so than Carlisle, and Steffens is going to hold the second spot while Carlisle's having some trouble getting around the lap car. Kelly Splicen also among them, but Carlisle will eventually do so. And as they go into turn 3, Quackenbush messes up his entry as you see Carlisle and Steffens quickly closing the gap. Carlisle now going for the lead, exiting 4, and Quackenbush gets into the wall a bit, and Carlisle will take the lead, lead the lap, and get 5 valuable bonus points, which will definitely help his cause towards advancing in the FARC-Off. Quackenbush is then going to lose the second spot to Steffens. And then Steffens is going to try to pass Carlisle for the lead. I think Carlisle just hit the wall. And Steffens gets under him, he dashes ahead of him at the line, but Carlisle gets a better run on the outside, entering turn 1, and is going to keep the lead. Steffens continues to fight back as they come down the backstretch, and Carlisle clears him to retain the lead. FARC-Off contender Tristan Kristoff is going to wash up in front of Zach Webster, and that's going to result in both of them going into the wall and spinning out. No one else hits them, and all will be well. Much like the last caution, we would have another incident racing back to the caution. Gio Arias is going to bounce off the wall and then get turned by Ricky McKenzie into the inside wall. Arias will continue with minimal damage. Almost everybody will come into pit road this time by. Bob Steffens will be the first among them to do so. Billy Bob Childers right behind him, and it will be Steffens that is the first one off of pit road. However, 8 cars would stay out under that caution, and Bradley Carlisle will lead on the restart. Lev Azaroff in second, Taylor Brill in third. And Carlisle quickly gets around the lap cars of Neil Miller and Kelly Splicen. So does Azaroff. And Carlisle runs turns 1 and 2 a bit wide. And that's going to allow Azaroff to close in the gap. And at the end of the lap, Carlisle's going to bounce off the wall. And that's going to allow Azaroff to come up to the side of him, coming to the start finish line, and he's going to have a nice shot at the lead going into turn 1, and Azaroff's going to take it pretty easily. Carlisle back to second. Pole sitter Monica Rook has worked her way back up to fourth. She's a ways back behind the top 3, and she's going to get passed going into turn 3 by Billy Bob Childers. Rook, who barely missed the FARC-Off on points, is going to drop back to 5th, and then is going to hit the wall, and is going to get passed by Chuck Johnson. Things are getting pretty crazy behind them. 4 wide going through turns 1 and 2, and that's going to result in a wreck. Kelly Splicen, Joshua Pacer, and John Byrne gets railed by Neil Miller. Todd Stater and Tom Brayton decides to join the party. It's a shame, too, because John Byrne was running in the top 10 at that point. He was one of the 8 cars that stayed out in the last caution. Anyway, that impact is going to finish off Miller. Everyone else would continue. There'd be a small incident racing back to the caution. Johnson Clapp's going to run turns 3 and 4 wide and is going to get in the back of Bob Steffens, who was moving up the track himself. Anyway, no harm, no foul. These guys will continue. This incident, however, will be more significant. Gio Arias is going to get loose exiting turn 4 after getting into the side of Zach Gott. He's going to slide down the front stretch, and then the team burn cars of Maury and Ronnie Halter are going to run into him. Where did they think they were going is anyone's idea. Anyway, that's going to take the Halters and Arias out of the race. Tough break for the defending Super Series champion. Again, almost everybody would come into pit road under this caution. You see a few cars stay out. Billy Bob Childers, Chuck Johnson, Jim Kidd, I think that's Ralph West back there, and a few others. About 10 or so cars stayed out, and Azarov's going to beat everybody out of pit road. This would mean that Billy Bob Childers would lead on the restart. Chuck Johnson, who pitted by himself under the first caution, is now back in second. Childers' Power Surge America teammate Jim Kidd is now in third. Kelly Splyson still a lap down, multiple laps down to be exact. Kid looks like he's, they're wrecking again. We didn't even get a lap in that time. Anyway, as I was saying, Kid's gonna use Splyson as a pick to get around Johnson for second, and it looks like it's gonna be Power Surge America 1-2 coming back to the caution. Let's see what happened back there. This happened right after the restart. Leslie Riggs is just gonna get turned by Ricky McKenzie, and Tom Brayton, with no time to react, just runs into her. Riggs would continue on, however, Brayton would retire from the race. So that makes it the sixth caution of the race, and we're not even at halfway yet. Two cars would pit under this caution. That would be Ralph West and Tristan Kristoff, who is a ways back there. However, the difference between Kristoff and West is that West would not return to the track. A terminal issue was discovered on the 62 car, and that would end his day. The Power Surge America cars would lead on the restart. However, they would have a hard time getting around the lap car of Kelly Splyson, who, despite how damaged that car is, I'm surprised that she's still able to keep up with the leaders, and Sedane Quackenbush is going to take advantage of that and go for the lead, as Splyson actually passes and clears Childers, and Quackenbush is eventually going to get on the inside of Splyson, but Quackenbush is not out of the woods yet. He's got Chuck Johnson right behind him, and Quackenbush looks like he's going to run the exit of 4 a bit wide. I think he may have scraped the wall, and Johnson in the lead of this race, with Lev Azarov right behind him. Taylor Brillen in third, try to go for second, but Azarov's gonna hold that position. Johnson is then gonna run turn 4 way wide. He's then gonna bounce off the wall, and here comes Azarov to take the lead of this race. Johnson will fall back to third. Brillen in second now, all over the back bumper of Azarov, trying to take the lead for herself. But then eventually, Azarov's gonna do the same thing, and it's going to allow Brillen to take back the lead of this race after she's been shuffled around a bit due to pit stops. And she's going to open up the lead, in fact. But then Azarov's going to close the lead back, and I think there may have been some contact there. And he's going to take back the lead from Brillen, exiting turn 4. Now, I don't want to say any of these drivers want the win more than the other, but for Azarov, that would mean a guaranteed spot in the next round of the FARC-Off. Soon after that, Brillen will get a much better entry into turn 1, and is going to get right under Azarov and take the lead back. As you see behind them, Chuck Johnson taking the third spot from Todd Stater, who's up here now. They've been shuffling back and forth for third. Keep in mind that Brillen is the only non-FARC-Off driver in this top 4. Azarov will then try to take the lead back, but he's going to have some problems. He's going to pull down the pit road. My guess was that a tire was going down on that 82 car, and he's going to bring it in, and it's going to lose a lap just shy of halfway. That is going to give Taylor Brillen a commanding lead over the rest of the field as she is ways ahead of Chuck Johnson and Todd Stater. Brillen, in her first year with Motor Assault Racing, has had a terrible season. First of all, she didn't start the season in this car. Leslie Riggs did, which is how Riggs qualified for the FARC-Off in the first place, winning at Sayre. Riley Knight's been in it for the road courses, but when Brillen's been in this car, she's done nothing but wreck. Good to see that she's finally turning it around. Here is that battle for second now between Stater and Johnson. Stater currently has it. Now, these guys are ways ahead of fourth place as Brillen continues to pull away from these guys. Meanwhile, up front, as we're now finally appearing to have a green flag run, Brillen's going to catch the tail end of the field. She's first going to catch up to her teammate, Leslie Riggs, and put her a lap down. That car's got a ton of damage on it, so she's going to get by her no problem. Brendan Carlisle's going to completely blow the entry of turn 1 and is going to slap the wall. I mean, we've seen cars hit the wall all day, that's no big deal, but those have been out of the exits of the turn, not in the middle of the turn. Carlisle was running 5th when that happened and is going to get passed by Zach Gott. Back up front, Brillen's now going to put FARC-Off contender Tristan Kristoff a lap down, and really nothing much Kristoff could do. He knows that he's not in a position to win in this AJ Young car. He's pretty much only racing for points to see if he can advance. Further back, Billy Bob Childers and Zdane Quackenbush are going to get together exiting turn four, and that's going to result in both of them into the wall and losing a ton of ground. I believe that was for 10th, I think. And they both got passed by Joshua Pacer, who has the front end ripped off of that car. Meanwhile, back to Brillin now, as she's having some trouble in the form of Zach Webster, who is not getting out of her way for whatever reason. This is not what she wants to see, as this is going to allow Chuck Johnson to close up the gap. And it's going to take a considerable amount of time for Brillin to get around Webster. As you just saw in the shot there, Johnson is now about a second behind Brillin now, but Brillin is eventually going to get it around Webster and is now going to try to reopen her lead. Brillin's going to continue to lap slower traffic, and this time it's going to be Keegan Mallory in the zero car for Dale Clough Racing. She gets around him with minimal effort, and Mallory's actually going to bounce off the wall, and this is significant because he's going to bounce off the wall and then block Chuck Johnson.
Someone tell the zero to run the drive while being lapped.
You can pretty much tell Johnson was not a fan of Mallory's driving there. Even in the Super Series last year, Mallory had a reputation of being kind of sluggish on track. Except this time it's because he's driving for a backmarker team. But anyway, that's going to cost Johnson a ton of ground on Brillin. More problems for Lev Azaroff now is he's back on pit road. Apparently that may not have been a tire issue we came in for before. That may have been a prelude to a much bigger issue. He's going to spend a number of laps on pit road trying to fix this one. Brillin's now going to catch up to her former teammate and mentor, Kevin Monroe, and put him a lap down. Monroe's been off the pace for much of the day after being involved in one of the earlier accidents. However, he's still probably going to leave here with a decent result, as there is only 22 cars still running, with a number of his FARC-Off competition out of the race already. Meanwhile, a ways back of the leader, we have a battle between Pearson Sweeney teammates, Billy Ray Smith Thompson, and Bradley Carlisle for, I believe, 6th, after Carlisle scraped the wall exiting turn 2. Smith Thompson briefly took the spot and then is going to hit the wall exiting turn 4, and Carlisle is going to take the spot back. A bit behind them, running in 9th, is Johnson Clapp. As you can see, he has got no front end on that car after being involved in the big one on lap 7. However, despite that, he's still in the top 10 and is maintaining speed with the guys around him at least. So Clapp, despite adversity earlier in the race, trying to start his FARC-Off on the right foot. Back in 2nd, Johnson is now 6 seconds behind Taylor Brillin as he just hit the wall there.
You're 6 seconds behind the 9, don't do anything reckless. We got pit stops coming up, repeat, pit stops coming up.
That was Johnson's crew chief letting him know that we got green flag pit stops coming up in a bit, and to let him know not to push it too hard. We all know about this team's luck throughout the years, throughout both of their incarnations. However, Johnson is happy to brag about the fact that he did with this incarnation owned by Catherine Azure what Nick and Frank Azure couldn't, and that was win a race, and that's what got him into the FARC-Off. But anyway, back up to Taylor Brillin now. She's just put Zach Webster, which I believe is now 2 laps down, if I'm not mistaken, and Joshua Pacer 1 lap down. I believe this now puts only 12 cars on the lead lap. We have some action going on track. Ricky McKenzie has continued to work his way through the field and is now passing Jim Kidd for 3rd. However, this is about roughly a half a lap behind the leader. Taylor Brillin has now put Billy Bob Childers and now Zdane Quackenbush a lap down. This now puts 10 cars on the lead lap as we're approaching the final quarter of the race. Green flag pit stops will begin on lap 74. Todd Stater will be the first among the lead lap cars to come into pit road. He'll be followed by Zach Gott back there. The very next lap, Chuck Johnson is going to come onto pit road now. He's not going to catch Taylor Brillin on track. He's going to try to do it on pit road. And, okay. And he's going to put it into the tires of the end of the pit wall instead. Now, I don't know what excuse Johnson's going to make up for this one, but it looks pretty obvious to me. He just decided to come into pit road the very last second, and there was only one way that was going to turn out. Johnson will go out of the race, and that will be the 7th caution of the day after a nearly 40-lap green flag run. This does not bode well for Zach Gott and Todd Stater, who were the only lead lap cars to come into pit road so far. This caution is going to come out and trap them both a lap down, while everybody else will make their pit stops under caution. And Taylor Brillin will lead them down pit road. The other cars that did not pit yet include Ricky McKenzie, Jim Kidd, Johnson Clapp, Bradley Carlisle, Billy Race with Thompson, Bob Steffens, and Monica Rook. Brillin would beat everybody out of pit road. The restart would come out with just 21 laps to go. 8 cars are now on the lead lap, 2 on the tail end of the lead lap, that being Stater and Gott, who of course put it on the green. They're hoping for a quick caution in hopes to get back on the lead lap, so they have to stay in front of Taylor Brillin to do that. However, as fast as Brillin's been all day, we don't know if that is going to be possible. And Brillin got a huge jump on that restart. Either that or McKenzie just didn't go. And Brillin already underneath Gott to put him back a lap down. And she's going to do so. Oh, maybe not. They get together. Both of them, Gott gets the wall and so does Brillin. That could have ended ugly. However, Brillin has such a big gap already over everybody else that didn't matter. Here's a new battle for second. Now, Jim Kidd currently has the spot. Bradley Carlisle in third. Bob Steffens now passing Carlisle for third, or at least trying to. All this is happening while Taylor Brillin starts to pull away from the rest of the field. And Bob Steffens gets a monster run coming out of turn four and is going to take the third spot and the second spot. Kidd tries to hold on to the spot going into turn one, but he's not going to hold on to it. Taylor Brillin has now reeled back in Todd Stater and is going to try to put him back a lap down. Stater did not get the caution that he needed. Stater doing all he can to try to stay in front of Brillin, but what do? Do you race her in order to stay on the lead lap, or do you let her go by? Stater hit the wall there, so that answered that question, and Brillin's going to get by him. Problems for Bradley Carlisle now. Looks like a cut tire on that car, and he's going to bring it into pit road and lose a lap as a result. Problems late in the race is going to cost him a top 5 finish. However, being that there's only 8 cars in the lead lap prior to this happening, this is not going to affect him too much. That's going to put the pole sitter, Monica Rook, back into the top 5. Rook barely missed the FARC-Off on points. In fact, I think she would have made it on points if it wasn't for the fact that Chuck Johnson and Greg Gray won the 2 races at Texas, which were first-time winners, which would then in turn bump her out. And Rook's got a problem now! She's pulling to the inside of the track! Something must be up with that car as she slows down to a crawl, and that's going to take away a top 5 finish for her. Todd Stater isn't exactly ready to give up the chance for a lead lap finish just yet. He's going to go on to the inside of Taylor Brillin going into turn 1. He got it, but Brillin does the crossover, gets back on the inside of Stater, and they both make contact, and they both get into the wall exiting turn 2. These two are racing each other way too hard for a battle that's not even for position, but it looks like that'll be the end of it. Bob Steffens in second has effectively pulled away from the rest of the field and seems to be the second fastest car on track next to Taylor Brillin, of course. Steffens, a FARC-Off contender, has competed in FARC in some capacity for 10 years now. While the last few years he's proven to be a championship contender every year, he has still have yet to win a race in this series. After Monica Rook's misfortunes, the fifth position is now held by Johnson Clapp, who looks more like he's driving a modified than a stock car. Clapp proved in the Super Series last season that he's definitely capable of getting good results in less than stellar situations. Not getting many opportunities here in the Elite Series, he took advantage of what he can get, and he took advantage of one of those opportunities by winning at 70-77, and now he's here in the FARC-Off contending for a title. And as if the day couldn't get any worse for Kevin Monroe, he's gonna have more issues now with 8 to go, and he's gonna bring it into pit road, and he's gonna slide back up onto the track. Thankfully, there's so few cars left on track and the field's so spread out, otherwise that would have been a total disaster. In the final moments of the race, Billy Bob Childers and Bradley Carlisle are going to get together exiting turn 4, and it's going to result in both of them sliding down the front stretch. Don't know the necessity of racing like that when that wasn't even for position. Carlisle's 1 lap down while Childers was 2 laps down. But anyway, that's going to bring up the caution with just 3 laps to go. And you see Taylor Brillin, with no competition, come to the caution flag at now 2 to go. And because of that, this race will end under caution. And Taylor Brillin, in dominant fashion, is going to take her first win of the season here at Loudoun. Brillen also steals the 10 bonus points for leading the most laps, which she doesn't necessarily need, being that she's not in the FARC-Off. However, I don't think she cares about that too much, as this is a much-needed up in what has been a season of downs for her. Bob Steffens is the highest-finishing FARC-Off driver in second. Jim Kidd finishes in third. Billy Ray Smith Thompson, the next highest FARC-Off driver, finishes fourth. And Johnson Clapp, despite being involved in the big wreck on lap 7, having the front end ripped off that car, finishes in 5th and puts himself in a good position to advance to the round of 10. I can tell you this now, Clapp will be in that same 09 car again at Watkins Glen before stepping back into the 69 for Grand Detour. Ricky McKenzie finishes in 6th, the last car on the lead lap. Todd Stater finishes 7th, the first car one lap down. Remember, he got screwed due to the timing of the second-to-last caution. The Gravity Racing teammates of Zidane Quackenbush and Zach Gott finished 8th and 9th, respectively. However, like Stater, Gott got screwed from the timing of the caution during those pit stops. Then Bradley Carlisle, despite being in the last caution, still leaves with a top 10 finish one lap down. The last car lap down, to be exact. And here is the FARC-Off standings after the first race of the round of 15. The standings pretty much reflect that of the finishing order, being that this is the first race of the round. Steffens, Smith, Thompson, Clapp, Stater, and Carlisle make up the top 5, which we've already talked about. So let's talk about the rest of the standings now. Tristan Kristoff is 6th in the FARC-Off standings after a 15th place finish, 3 laps down. He actually also got the hard charger bonus, which is 10 points right there, that allowed him to jump over Joshua Pacer, who's 7th, who finished 13th. And I think it's important to note that Kristoff will be back in the 69 car for Wild West Racing at Watkins Glen next week, the same team he won at Road America with. And I can assure you that he'll be looking to do the same this time that he can't do in the subpar equipment he's been driving for the rest of the season. Only this time, it will guarantee him a spot in the round of 10. Leslie Riggs is 8th after a 16th place finish, also 3 laps down. Remember, like we talked about earlier, she will not be at Watkins Glen next week, so she will be one of the few drivers that will have to rely on their average finish if they're going to advance to the round of 10. And, well, she finished the race at least, so she's got a decent average finish going forward. And after a miserable day, Kevin Monroe is 9th. After finishing 17th, Lev Azaroff, who was the final FARC-Off driver to finish the race and final driver to finish the race overall, is in the cutoff position in 10th after finishing 21st, 5 laps down. Chuck Johnson, Mark Thompson, Dan Lechleiter, Greg Gray, and Kenny George III did not finish the race, therefore they are the bottom 5, and if the round ended today, they would be the 5 that would be eliminated. George, Gray, Lechleiter, and Thompson were involved in the big wreck, while Johnson didn't finish due to his own stupidity. I don't care what excuse he has. Gray will be another one that will have to probably rely on his average finish to advance into the round of 10, on the count that, remember, he shares that 78 car with multiple drivers. And looking at my notes now, he will not be in the car at Watkins Glen. However, he will be in it for the cutoff race at Grand Detour. So the first race of the 2016 FARC-Off is in the books, and things are already looking pretty interesting so far. We'll have to see what happens from here when the FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series heads to race 2 of the FARC-Off, the LACO Breaks 150 at the Watkins Glen International in New York.